First of all, I just want to thank Kevin for having me out, and I want to thank you all for showing up. Wanted to thank you, Brent, for the great job he's been doing. I love that it's been a little nerve wracking on the video, but I love the fact that you know, I've checked out a number of meetings from home, so great. So I've been working on some GWT stuff and some mobile stuff, and some things have been coming together, and yet I've seen a bit of a decline in jobless research, so I thought we could talk about that and see what we've done to address that. But first of all, I had a question for the group. Does anybody know who this gentleman is?
By face.
Okay, I'll give you another hint. I'll give you a name. Anybody know Daniel's people? Daniel is actually the CEO of the founder. Daniel, he started CEO in 1996. I was part of a group that we were thinking about doing, we were doing some job development, and he actually started first out at Adobe. I started the first meetings there, and I got involved very early on. So I just wanted to clarify, I'm actually not a founder. I couldn't sleep at night. It's easier to say that since I did it for 12 years. So now it's on the record. So who am I really? I focus on helping businesses leverage mobile, Java, and enterprise stuff. Quite a list of bigger clients, and some smaller ones too. Been doing Java since 95, and mobile since 98. Had some fun places that have done Java. I'm sure a lot of you have done cool places as well. I don't know, Java apps or anything else places. And one of OSs. I've been in the shadows the last 2 years or so, but still passionate about this. All right. So, why am I here? This is kind of a call to arms. There's a change happening in the industry, and I thought it would be kind of too good to talk about it and to see that it's coming. I'll talk about it in a sec more, but there are choices businesses will be facing as these technologies change. And it's our job as those people providing the technology services for businesses to make sure that we're providing, make sure our businesses are well involved. And there are some smart choices that we as developers can make that enable businesses to focus on their resources and building a better advantage and not reinventing the wheel. And so we can always make sure that we are, that's what we're doing for our company, right? So our company is, it's going to survive and thrive in the industry. And sometimes it's easy to start doing some cool stuff and want to reinvent the wheel. You say, hey, I can do better this or that, and sometimes you can't. So there are some smart choices that are going to cost businesses less and all the time and ongoing maintenance. And as other developers, we are actually at risk of being commoditized unless we differentiate through innovative solutions. And I'll discuss a little bit more about that in a minute here. But it sounds a little grandiose, but it's true in a sense. So I just copy pasted this. This is Java's website. These are the successes in Java. And is it possible that Java's reach is on the decline? It almost happened, though. 12 years ago, 11 years ago, Microsoft published Java from Windows XP. Well, no big deal. We just put Java on. We've got Java on there, right? No problem. It's no longer a zero install, right? I mean, it's not there right away. And then, we have here our old Steve Jobs saying, gee, we're not going to include Java any longer in the OS. We'll let little scary because it's about controlling distribution channel applications. And if we decide we want to run our application to Java, and Mr. Jobs decides he doesn't want Java applications, he controls our future. And so that's something we're going to keep our eye on. But the whole goal, So, you could say maybe that's a little bit of a decline in JavaScript engineering because you don't have zero install, and maybe you're not going to be able to put your Java apps into the Mac store. Okay. Is it significant? Not yet. But when we start looking at the number of client devices, and this is some numbers I pulled together from this is pulled together from a number of sources, so it's probably not completely correct, but what I did is I looked at all the mobile devices and desktop systems. Notice we have some here is our Linux clients, just because they're not that simple. So that's where we're at today in terms of who owns or what piece of the pie is provided by what OS. Turns out that that's about 91% job here. You're not going to have anything in the iOS category. And it's unlikely I'm not certain it was in the Windows Phone 7. So we go to tomorrow being 2015. And if you take the current projections, there's this huge change, right? This is as smartphones overcome desktops. And one of it's my wife. She's in Turkey. There's been an emergency. So I think you're always going to have that tension, right? there's always going to be this tension in any kind of market, where you've got suppliers that are going to want to differentiate their products and build some defensible moats, and suppliers or consumers that are going to want to cheaper and easier to purchase, and at multiple choice. So the Java cross-platform tools and HTML, JavaScript, CSS are technology for consumers. Sorry. I'm not used to saying it's been a while. consumers tools that commoditize OSs and browsers and everything from there on in. And DOS, Windows, and now Linux are tools that commoditize the underlying hardware, right? So what DOS did to hardware, making it cheap and available everywhere, cross-platform tools have done that to OSs. Sometimes that monetization goes too far. So the last generation of laptops, anybody buy a $300 or $400 laptop? How long did it last? The reason I have a Mac is not because I'm a Mac fanboy, although only Linux is pretty nice. What would happen is, when it buys the Mac and say, hey, look, it's got this magnetic connector. I'm like, okay, magnetic connector. And then I bought a cheap laptop for $20. And the battery would be on the right way. And then what happened? Well, you could plug in all the time and draw a connector in the back and break soft and draw a connector on the board. Right? The plastic can just break. And all those things are an example of the race of law. As they tried to make laptops cheaper, nobody was differentiating on design. They were just trying to get cheaper and cheaper. So there's this balance going on, right? Is a problem, right? This platform fragmentation. And fragmentation problem to varying degrees, but that's kind of this, okay, we'll rally around HTML5. That's what we said. Turns out, you know, this problem of platform fragmentation is so large that a bunch of startups have jumped in trying to become the cross-platform tools. In fact, this report that I quote here, Vision Mobile, they've got to be cross-platform tools. They've been developed over the last 3 or 4 years, and they've got over 100 different kinds of tools. Turns out the majority of them are all about programming in web, HTML, JavaScript, CSS, and getting that to run on mobile devices. We've seen that mobile devices are where the growth is going to happen. Right? And when I say mobile devices, I really am referring to tablets. So, as more and more of these things become available, you need less and less Java developers. some quotes I basically it's bad font to read through the presentation, so I'll leave it up there long enough. If you're interested, you can read it, but that's, you know, a direct quote from their report. And there are larger tools. This is really where things are headed. And it's really not about who's parents, right? We can go on about what's the great things about Java, what's the great things about JavaScript. Of course, I have been pointing one out for JavaScript. It wasn't very flattering. This is from the inventor, the guy who wrote JavaScript.
But I think even in the mobile space, so, I mean, you'll still need at least two different kinds of applications and stuff that lies in between, right? You have the native clients that take advantage of everything on the handset, and then you'll have the thin clients, more of the HTML5, JavaScript, and so on and so forth. And there'll be stuff in between, but I don't think the thin clients are going away anytime soon, though, right? I mean, they're not. I know there are some cool kits out there that let you kind of have, you know, the best of both worlds where they let you go to HTML and Java, HTML5 and JavaScript, and they also provide some native sort of access to some native stuff like accelerometer and things like that. But at the end of the day, though, I mean, you know, C's not going away. I mean, I don't know if Java necessarily is going away from the mobile space, especially given Android's success.
Yeah, and let me not say that. I mean, that's not what I'm trying to say. That Java is going away from the mobile space. There is always going to be a need on mobile devices to have applications that are written for that specific device. And you need to do it in the native language that device offers. And I think that's a little biased to be a Java developer, but I think it was really smart of Google Spark to make sure that Android was based on Java. And so they could tap this huge number of Java developers. But if you're an Android developer now, and you have to ask yourself, what am I doing as an application? Can it be done as a web app only offline? If it can, then your job may be replaced by a web developer. Now, what I'll talk about here in a little near the end, but there are a lot of features on your phone that are not going to be available immediately up for JavaScript. Right? You want to access GPS, you want to access the contact database, you want to access storage, you want to access a camera. Lots and lots of things are not part of HTML. But these frameworks that we're looking at do provide that. And you know, I think one you referred to was the phone gap, which we talked about here, provides that those APIs, allows you access it in JavaScript. And then gives you your Java, your JavaScript to run within a browser. So it provides a full. So there are changes coming in that sense, I think. There has been this huge call. I mean, how many of you how many folks here are Android developers right now?
A lot of sight.
Just one?
Not for work.
Oh, not for work yet, right? On our own, right?
Yeah.
Okay, and how many are iOS developer? Okay. So While I talk.
Who is Brandon? Brandon who? What's his last name?
It's Ike. Yeah, it's a nice color there. E-I-C-H. He's quite a guy. Oh, look at that. It's a microphone.
There he is.
There he is. You should ask. Creator Justin.
Oh, I see. University of Illinois, maybe that should be.
So, we're, anything else?
Yeah. Do you see it as a commodification? Because it seems like some of the JavaScript stuff is pretty sophisticated as well, and the JavaScript developers are making as much or more. So, I don't necessarily see it as race at the bottom or being replaced by web developers. It's just a transition maybe towards JavaScript, or maybe I'm wrong. What do you think about that?
I was really referring to the negative side of the monetization, not necessarily saying that JavaScript was a race to the bottom. But I can see where you're getting that. there are some, it's not about language merits, really. It's about where your VMs, if you call a JavaScript engine a VM, then that's going to be open on the clients. But that only means one. And so, well, let me take a look further here. I guess the point was, okay, so we have a lot of web developers that are coming in to develop mobile apps. And then how will you differentiate your skill set? Right? How are you going to take besides doing custom apps, the ones that can't be done through extended JavaScript, extends out on the UX, then where do you provide value?
Learn JavaScript.
Learn bilingual.
They should argue those Java developers will be better JavaScript developers than web developers.
You had learned a lot of things
that develop expectations for web dependency management, the development of error checking.
Okay.
Are you going to talk about server-side JavaScript? It seems to be a bigger threat than Node.js.
Yeah, right. I started to touch on that in this presentation, but didn't finish. But I think we should talk through that. And we'll get to the question over here in just a second. So So I'm going to make the case here in a minute that multiple languages incur a burden. So we'll talk about that, but the idea is, well, what if you just use JavaScript all the way down? Right? That's why you have JavaScript in the server. And I'll say that, 16, 17 years of job now, and working on the server side, advanced transactions, and multi-threading, and the whole gamut of enterprise technologies. One or two little, JavaScript servers, I'm not sure is going to be able to match up to that level of enterprise technology. And all those brains have put it,
Is there any kind of also focusing mostly on global space? I mean, your 2015 projections are predominantly saying that taking into account global space is a huge market for platform and for devices and everything. But I mean, this is a whole group here. Obviously, it's not scientific, but a lot of us are all working on server side. Not necessarily on mobile devices, so if we don't feel dependent on the encroachment of iOS on App 7.
But he didn't ask how many people are working on mobile apps for
really what I'm showing is, thinking about it in a big, big sense, right? There is a set of computing resources behind the scene, how we get to it from whatever device doesn't really matter. And that we as engineers need to make that available to our businesses and whatever tools they're accessing upon. And so I think what we'll cover here is this work to give the people by value. You can write one set of code that works in a web browser, and a web browser on a desktop. There's a better question back here. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I was just wanted to comment that, I mean, this whole theory that JavaScript and HTML5 are going to replace or supersede Java, that's all client-side processing. I mean, you're not going to run. You're still going to need to plug those into an AJAX server or some type of data store or some type of scientific application or some type of massive processing services. And on that side, those technologies don't apply.
Right.
At all.
I think what I was just saying, the JavaScript is not going to be able to make much about server side, getting server side.
So, but your comment, your pivotal thing at this screen is your comment was it costs to do two languages. How can we save that cost? Moving on to the next screen.
Let me move a little bit, and then we'll. Okay, George, one more, and then we'll see it.
I'm not a fan of JavaScript, but I will tell you that the Node.js engine is in the 10K group. 10,000. What's that?
C10K.
C10K. Yeah. 10,000 connections per second.
Wow.
So
for a single server, 10,000 transactions per second. It was this wall that no one. It was the sound that everybody.
Can you speak for everyone?
C10K was sort of like the sound barrier for any server application on a single machine. Getting to 10,000 connections was basically impossible because every single piece of the system starts to rattle and fall apart as you approach that number. As George is finally pointing out, Node.js is one of the ones that's broken that. Nginx has as well, and a couple others. But it's still a selective group.
It's rare. Can I choose between Node.js and Node.js?
No, I can't. But you have the same problem.
Maybe I don't want to. It's your point.
It's another moment. It's your point.
It is.
All right, so if we take a look at your traditional web app UI architecture, you've got your browser, and you're going to run Flash, Java, you got your presentation here, and you got PHP, Ruby on Rails, a bunch of different languages you can do that from. In the back end, in your services here, more often than not, you're using Java or C Sharp to, because of that, those enterprise technologies, right? Thread object session, connection pooling, strong transactional semantics, queuing, object oriented mapping, LDAP, monitoring, instrumentation. Those kinds of things are, I guess, what Java's been building up over the years, the Node.js, JS is, it's taken a long time to build all of that. And that whole implementation. One of the problems, if we look at this architecture, the traditional one, your browser simply just putting another page, and your presentation here is keeping track of the state of the page. And so really what we're starting to make an argument for here is more of an AJAX one. That just pages. We want to hold more information in the browser and make communication to the back-end systems as stable as we can. So you're using the computing power that most users bring in the browser, leveraging that rather than having to pay for it by building a whole presentation. And let's see what I got. Yeah. Somebody like new developers, and that was there's unnecessary complexity when you've got so many different tiers and different languages, right? Really, to do what we're talking about, JavaScript, need that in the browser. Presentation tier, a lot of folks go, Java developers are hard to find and they're expensive. So I'm going to go build some PHP presentation tier, and then we'll have Java developers center on the service tier. And, there's some value in that, but there's a bunch of overhead. So, the communication. bandwidth requirements between developers is pretty significant.
There's no scale there,
right? You can't just throw another developer at that problem and solve it twice as fast. It just doesn't work. And so when you have more people, you slow down, and it takes more to keep going. And there's this beauty that there's no code like no code. The less code you have to write, the less code you have to maintain, the cheaper your system can be, the easier it is to understand. And it's my goal. I want to be able to write a system where I control, I can make quickly affect every tier of the system. Okay, so this is just talking about user experience. And I'll say that this is a collection of slides that we'll get. And so sometimes, you know, I'm going to say things that are very obvious to you, which are developers. So, no offense intended, I just grabbed slides from folks that were like, oh, that's right. So this is about Ajax clients and how great they are, and that it was a truly Ajax client. You've got all that code running in the router, and it is not going back and forth around routes, except to get just the data you need. And the problem with that, and I'm just briefly in this picture, the presentation here, you got scalability where the state of each and every user and where they are in their workflow is costing you to have a computer track that for the user. And then keep track of that, and then when you want to scale it and have and multiple system handling, you have to come up with solutions like session, shoot the caching, keep that state back and forth, and it gets overwhelming. And so, I spell it out in just business, terms. Presentation here roughly doubles the server data from the UI, which increases the hardware and data center costs. And, as an architect, this is the part that gets me. I want that simplicity, I want to be able to access the whole system. If we look at this model, and again, this is a slide that I've taken from another project I worked on, so I haven't changed the terms in here. This is really supposed to imply a domain model. This was actually a domain model for one client, an organization with users and machines, and that's how I learned the model. And really, we have to take that structure, and we have to duplicate that across every tier. Have some kind of representation of the browser, some of it in the presentation here, some of it, all of the services here, and of course the database, right? That structure goes there. And then the fun part comes, the impedance mismatch between them. You start talking different languages, then you've got to have a marshaling mechanism between JavaScript and Java and from, or Java, in this case, JavaScript to PHP, when we were at, anybody here, you were talking about Clearwire? Right? So in that case, it was, maybe a little bit of JavaScript on the front end to PHP in the back end, and then you had this, I was in charge of working on the domain model, so we had to write the model to go both places. So we said, all right, what can we make sure that these two languages talk correctly? Well, we'll use XML and a schema to make sure they, are kept in sync. So now, we're having to include a third technology, PHP, XML, Java, and marshal between all of those and make sure that they all fully understand the model and the semantics of each of those values that we pass back and forth. And then a lot of times this just ends up being value objects, right? So if I'm going to have an object and I want to send it across the wire, well, it's got behavior, that doesn't mean we need to do it in JavaScript. It's a Java behavior, and it certainly doesn't do anything good in PHP, or whatever, in your presentation here. So this is where I'm coming from when I say, so much useless overhead, so much burden comes with that kind of structure. And then, of course, your organization or yourself have to have all these skills. Now, you're still going to need some of these. I think it's great if you can have all of them. your mind on which language you're working in and what's the best way to do things. And so the more you can reduce that complexity, the better your system is going to be. So here's the true sort of front-end architecture. And this was, who's going to get half of these? This is this diagram. Let's pull it off the web. Anyway, getting an idea of you're using basically in this case it's GWT, but you've got a server that downloads a JavaScript app and then just does this request to the back end by communication here, but it's not doing UI at all. And so that's how you end up with a much simpler system. This is always going to run JavaScript, but can make now stateless calls, just requests to a, and then we're talking GWT, assuming Java here, and this is going to be Java compiled JavaScript here. And this is just any web server search down application version. Okay, so. So this is a step better. structure. Okay, so this is, this is the screen that shows. If you're going to use just an Ajax framework in JavaScript, you're going to have some JavaScript running over here, this is Java running here. And so you're still going to have some duplicate structure, and it's still in this mismatch. Duplicate behavior. Behavior has to run written twice on both devices. So finally, enter GWT, where you can write it once and run the service here and the browser once and compile to JavaScript. One structure definition competes in this match, one behavior definition.
No
database. What's that?
Ideally, database city one.
Well, that was
yes, with your diagram show.
Yes, I was trying to simplify for that. All right, so I can talk about these things. But here, to your point, there's our database. We still need that. But if we've done coding correctly, I mean, if we take advantage of GPA, which this client wasn't sold on yet. Then you can write one definition to define what the database structure looks like if you're implementing it. Go ahead.
So Raymond, if you, from ground zero, does it require your developers, right, the front end, the back end, all of them to adhere to the design pattern, the specific pattern, right, so that those objects translate from the document object model, right, in JavaScript to, you know, whatever encapsulation you want to inherit in your app or your middle tier. Is that kind of where you're going, or something?
Is there some patterns you should use?
Well, the ground level hierarchy, what you start with, and then after that, you know, I guess piecemealing together somebody else's mistake, but if you require, you know, some consistency in the objects, depending on
you still have to divide it into two physical tiers and know how much communication is across them. It doesn't magically cut it and separate the two, but the advantage here is one language.
One language, one definition. I don't have to keep two files in the same.
There are some
one design pattern.
So,
two-tier architecture for the three-tier.
Here's an example of a class. It's off the cloud, I apologize. And it's not well-formed, as well-formed as it could be. But this is a class that actually runs, compiles in GPT. We've got our JPA annotations up here, right, and down here. JPA is pretty, basically, ignore that. GWT compiles. It ignores those. These constraints, GWT has understands constraints, and you can leverage those in the UI. But you can also use those constraint definitions in your service and in persistence. So, when integrity is going to persist, we'll look at some of these things and say, okay, that's our valid. And then we can have true non-meaning sync, all is developed on the same page. And so now that's a value that you can provide. Because you can, as a Java developer, you take this approach and you use GWT, even if you're not doing mobile yet, right? You see mobiles down the road, you know your business is going to want to use them, right? I'm here. Yeah, let's see, we want to use bring your own device and do that. So that means, wow, how am I going to get all these devices? And this is how. You begin using JavaScript frameworks like PhoneGap talked about that will allow you to take and run your application on mobile devices. Your application is already running. Let's see, put it this way. You devise a web, right? You devise this for your standard web browser. It's a rich client. All this is part of one rich clients right now. So now you've got all that work in GWT. And now they say, well, gee, you really like mobile. Well, you know, I can use most of it. I just have to scale down my screens, right? Then I'm going to have to test, make sure that we're on the right target devices, we're not too bloated. So one of the things that I'm trying to put out there now is, if I can express this to you, if you go back to your businesses and you tell them, you know, hey, I have solutions for how we can move in the future and how we can get rich clients now, and GWT can get us there, then I don't have to go work on some silly PhD. But the point being that we still are providing value, right? It's a much smaller system, it's easier to maintain.
You mentioned a couple of names there. Was that encapsulating a Java, a GWT generated application such that it's running in a browser window, but it's all in a separate app on the phone?
That's right.
It doesn't have to be running by hitting a page to get to it and be
you
in the browser as far as users are concerned. It actually can run in a browser frame that's independent of the actual.
Tell you what, I should bring something very in, but maybe I'll just bring it up early now. If you've got an iOS device right now or an Android device, search GWT and PhoneGap and bring down in your App Store and bring down the app, and you'll be able to see an application that is written in Java, compiled in JavaScript, then compiled with this PhoneGap mechanism to be a native application on the device.
It's just really a simplified browser running it inside itself.
Exactly.
Have you actually done this?
Yeah.
How well does it work?
There are some limitations to sizes of things. And there are
kind of the thing that I've been getting into is that GWT has quite an overhead for operating browser. So it has some big downloads. And for web apps or phone apps, that downloading that through the network is.
So what's happening in that case, though, when we start talking about phone gap, it becomes an offline application.
You have to change the update. So it would be nice to update it through the phone, wouldn't it?
So, yes, and for enterprise applications, you've got enterprise tools. If you want to put it in Apple's App Store, they're not as keen on you just changing your app behind an app that you don't even approve. So there are some limitations here that we have to keep in mind if you want to run in the App Store in a lot of cases we'll talk about enterprise apps. If you want to provide access to those, there are on the Apple side. Enterprise tools that serve out your app without having to go to the App Store. And with Android, you can serve it out. So you can bypass the store rentals. But
if they're downloading an app or creeping up, then anytime you change your data model, don't you have a convenience mismatch again? The same one you're trying to worry about using GWT on all these years.
I'm not sure it's quite the same. Yeah, anytime you change your data model, you're going to have was saying, it's not like, it's not an impedance mismatch between languages, right? Data types. You might say, yeah, move this data type from here to here.
You go from one to one to one to many.
Yeah, you're still going to need some page applications, but you as a user, you as a developer, understand all those tiers along the way and define that. So rather than, well, here's the domain model, I pass it off to the PHP developer. And hope I didn't understand that I wired that wrong. Oh, but your date for format out this, the right format out like that. Those are the real ones. Not being grabbed our communication model.
So to put it another way, the tiers are still there, but the platform's kind of taking care of all the work for you in terms of propagating the changes and things like that. You're working in more of a homogenous environment, and so it's a lot easier.
Right, right. And you've actually gotten rid of a tier entirely. Presentation tiers are not gone.
Question about that, though. So moving state to the client, what about security? I mean, you've taken your presentation tier and shipped it off to the client. What about worrying about what kind of data is now ending up on the client? I mean, doesn't that add complexity in terms of trying to figure out, well, you know, is this information really, does it need to be sent to the client or not?
I mean,
right.
So, I mean,
those are the thoughts, right?
That's true. You want to think that through, right? And make sure that is part of your new programming.
But it means you don't have the one true object to eat them all.
That's not exactly true.
Standard database one and cleaned up for the UI.
not exactly true, right? So you would say there are certain fields I never want sent to my server or to my device. One of those ways you can do that is smart printing. Another one is,
for example, private keys are something you definitely don't want sent to the client side.
You're going to want some kind of ID, right?
So you can. So then you've got to do a translation of some sort. It's like the session ID thing, right?
No. So why wouldn't you want your primary key? So
let's say you have a functionality in the client which lets you view a profile information or something like that, right? And so if you key off of a primary key or something, you're shipping that off to the client. So the alien just tries some IDs and see if it works.
You're
confusing client security with server security. You still need to have server security to see whether this is allowed to see these IDs.
Right, but I'm saying you're pushing more of what used to be server-side kind of functionality to client-side, so the scope of what all it is that you have to worry about from a security perspective is now increased, in my opinion.
I think you do need to think about it more, right? But
everything.
You would certainly think about that anyway, right?
Yeah, with JavaScript, you do the same thing. I mean, you send
the JSON. But now the framework is doing it for you.
It's default send nothing, and you have to keep adding things. Well, I want to send this, and I want to send this, and I want to send this. When it's end-to-end, you're sending everything, and it's allowing everything.
And we have to mark the ones that are in.
So nothing is sent client that you don't allow.
Yeah, well, I guess that's what I'm saying, is you just gotta worry about more about what it is that you're allowing to be sent to the client.
Sure, sure. So, and I think in one sense, you're bringing down the view, the control, and it's the model and the data, you know, that's gonna go back and forth. And when you request, when the client is requesting that from the server is like, well, you know, what is it, what's the secret handshake, what's the key, the token, you know, that I should allow you to have that data.
If your model contains stuff that the client shouldn't be able to have, you've made a mistake. You have an architecture problem. It's irrespective of what you're using.
Yeah, I mean, you might look at your model and say, okay, well, I might need to use a little more composition. I split out this set of data so that it's not necessarily the center of the client. Make that transient, or there are other ways of doing that. And sometimes, there might be cases where you don't want the full representation of something sent across. You're just going to want a descriptor. That's what I mean as well. Here's a descriptor of this thing, but that requires server-side resources to do its full function. So, talk about it, send about that descriptor back and forth.
Right.
when you start getting into relational models in a more manner, you don't want to send the whole graph across anyways.
Absolutely not. And in fact, I pulled together some tips and tricks of things that I've discovered in working with GWT. And so I'll just kind of skim through those. And one of the things that we're going to talk about is that very practical. Anything else? Go ahead. All right, and I won't go into my own detail, even though I have my number of slides. I actually only have 12 bucks in a row. You know, with GWT, you just have to make sure that you're breaking your components down. I love Maven. Maven's done a great job in helping me make sure that my system is componentized correctly. And so then you have testable components in each of those. And so, one of the problems with GWT is they bring, when you're running some unit tests, they're bringing an in-memory browser that's running, so it can run the JavaScript, and that can take a long time. So you want to make sure that you carefully separate out your components so that your narrow scope of testing needs to happen for each component. This is something that doesn't change often. Here's how we're talking a little bit about model subsetting. So I was working one line, that was one really good question I had. How am I going to take care of this is a model that can't go to the client? And so GWT compiled will make fields, methods, and classes that are not used in the browser that compile. So that's one thing we can count on. Sensitive fields can be marked transient and so they won't be sent to the wire. And then I talked about kind of a descriptor object. Talked about a descriptor object that I use, which is, hey, here's something that describes something. You know, it refers to things on the server. It's not the real thing, it's just a descriptor. It was a describer. I can get a hold of it.
So I guess I was kind of referring back to days of computer code, but
or you can call it a catalog description. There's the real thing and then there's a description of the real thing, right? So if you look at a catalog, the catalog has a description of, oh, this is a car, it's, you know, got these features. Then there's the real thing. And that real thing is not going to run a browser, it's not going to serve. So that description gives you enough information to be able to find that object. And that object actually may, as part of its, it may use composition that holds a descriptor or describer. And so you can ask the part just sends that out. Whole object is still on the server.
It's not as full standard as the object, it's not like part of the object that gets its way to get it.
Yes. So you think there's a reference with additional information that the user may need in the browser. And then that can go be sent back and forth to the server and can be used within the actual object on the server. And so that actual object on the server delegates the request and information. The minus is actually ID. So it's enough of a description to pass back and forth that they both care about, but there can be more detail on the server.
Make sense?
Well,
wouldn't there be some objects?
Oh yeah.
Overhead.
Yeah. I mean, I think you only do that if you have it, right? So that's one way of dealing with it. That can't go back and forth, and then you still want to be able to browse. So one product we're looking at, the Can GWT, they had SQL embedded in their domain model, XML APIs embedded in their domain model. And to the extent possible, you try to make your domain model just like your domain and try to narrow down the dependencies on your shell system as much as possible. And so one of the nice things about annotation is that it allows you to provide additional information in your model, but without implying any information. And so, the browser is not going to be easy, so you shouldn't depend on SQL in your domain model. It's not a very they were using JPL, so they're doing all the marshaling in and out of the database, going back and forth the database themselves. This is another question. What happens to the new browser? How can we support those? So there are ways that the GWT provides. Here's how I can add a new browser version, how to compile for it, or a new version. And one of the things that, and I'm sure you guys have the GWT presentations, but one of the things that happens is that the GWT will compile for each different browser, right? And I mean, sometimes that gets burdensome. Like, I wanted to prove that we had internet transition, right? So I had a couple languages in there, and for every browser, I now compile twice because I had two languages, right? I had three languages, and I'm not compiling three times as long, one for every kind of browser. So it's cool. Prove that we had one language in there, that was internationalizable, but I waited until the end before I started having this other stuff. And I think you really want to make sure you've got a good build server set up and can handle those full builds later on.
I was just wondering why that was the case. I mean, is it because the content itself would gain different languages or something? Or
why it compiles like that? So what GWT does really well is that it's trying to make sure whatever browser gets only the JavaScript that's valid for it. Right? And so, i.e. the stories for being very different from WebKit, which is what Chrome. So when you're saying a bunch of, if this, then do this, they pre-compile it in advance and just separate it out. Rather than going to the code at one time and going, okay, but I can't figure out what to do until I figure out what browser I'm in, so they do that.
Yeah, but this, you said the...
Even for language.
For language?
Yeah, even optimized.
Okay. So there's a whole...
wanted to, but you don't usually want it to because of.
So you're just doing it for Chrome with the Firefox. Cross your fingers, your Chrome doesn't break it anyway with their next update.
Sure, your pen is on. I mean, you can't, if you discover that there really is a big issue, you need to have two separate versions. You can't take a little longer.
In our own testing, we discovered that Chrome 2000 was, you know, broke us up in Chrome 1752.
That's the
fault. So you then face
the choice. You just lost a few years, and that's where we're going to be.
You then face the choice, right? You can either put in a test or run it. It says do it this way.
Team, he was not happy with the decision to abandon Excel and go to the RNC.
point was is that we have about 200 or 300 objects we can send, mm-hmm. and in a week we've written three serializations. And I said, no, this is not going to scale. But all I have to do is put serializable in there, or tie it to T serializable, yeah. and poof, the problem is solved. So,
all right.
So that gRPC is annotations and say, look, this object will go over the wire. Please do that. It's just serializable.
Yeah, in fact, I'll cover it a little bit here in a second.
And I'll mention that when I first gave it to GWT, they did a lot of JSON. Now, manual mining of that was
available. Yeah, I'm going to cover that. Anybody else? What do you guys use for communication back then?
With the big
RPC.
What's
that? What's
that? The
quit
RPC.
Quit?
What's that?
Anybody?
RPC. So it's everybody's falling into the regular fewest lines of code and it's a
yeah, right? I mean, who wants to maintain all that? So, you know, say if you look at, and then this is again, we kind of just got this, but if you look at XML versus JSON, really, why do we use JSON? Only when we're using working on a web browser, right? Because it's JavaScript documentation, so only if we've got a JavaScript engine, we want to be using JSON. I've seen it used them, you know, but I guess overused, like we've seen XML overused, but you know, abused perhaps. It doesn't have a formal schema definition, so there's no formal paper representation. And having now written a marshaling mechanism using JSON, if you want to send a collection back and forth, you know, you're going to have to be very clear, the person on the other end, what it is that's going to come over and how they can unmarshal that and remarshal it. You don't want to do that perfectly. You want to have very strong contracts in place, and that's where XML can be handy, but XML is very slow.
Did you write your own plain site reflection?
Not reflection.
Okay.
But yeah, we're talking about computers today. So no formal schema definition in JSON, but it is with the parse web browser, and XML is great for B2B communication, it's slow for large non-referencing data sets, but and very slow for browser parsing, and I'll show an example of speed timings. Beauty is there's a formal schema definition, so that's a contract that can be assured of all devices, and that's how, when I talked earlier about Clearwire, how we were making sure the PHP team and the Java team were communicating clearly to make sure we had a very formal XSD to make sure that both teams knew what was going on. And that can be useful. Not always quite enough, but it's and you know, one thing you can use with XML, you can actually make it crash with JSON. JSON doesn't necessarily have any reference in the back and stuff. But XML does provide easy way to reference these references for these businesses. All right, so here you guys had Jay Ward a while back in a CJ presentation. What is it? It's got a service backend system, a cloud based solution, Polyglot. I wasn't even here, I was here virtually, but recently. Anyway, he used to work with
Heroku.
What's that?
That's because of Heroku.
Heroku.
Yeah.
Thank you. That guy, he actually did this. He was doing this stuff as a part of Adobe and Flex timing when he was working with those guys. And if you look closely here, what you guys, if you're just going to send over a table, you know, if you're just going to stand and render HTML from your server and send it over, it's going to take this much time to execute on the server and this much time to render. And then you send it by a SOAP, and you get this much server time, this much transfer time, this much parse time in your browser, and then some render time, right? Render time is interestingly less than the sending a table in HTML. But and if you look at the difference between SOAP and AJAX, XML, so I guess that's more of a less solution where you don't have all the way with SOAP, you know, there's some other questions. And then here's why people use JSON. Because this is your part of time in your browser.
20% slower than the literal HTML that the browser needs. It's what you do with JSON.
So
whatever that scale is there.
So that's, you know, that's one of the draws of JSON. But now we're talking about JSON versus GWT, RPC, modifications versus new. And when I talk about, when I say this, I think what's really happening under the covers of, I keep saying GWT, it's true, the Google folks call it quit, and I should call it quit. So with RPC, I think under the covers here, they're still using JSON, but they are calling to an API, and then that API is being used to call to your objects. So it's not quite true to say JSON versus GWT, because they're both using JSON. So if we take this as some kind of domain model, and then we look at a version where you're hand coding JSON, and I think this is what you said the guy started to do on your project. For those of you that are new to GWT, if you want to program code, there's only ever going to run in the browser. So you want to have some Java, but you decide, hey, I really want to embed some JavaScript in the middle. You have these interesting little comments here, as you can see in this red. So this is the standard Java comment, and then it's followed by just two additional characters, and that is a signal to the GWT compiler that, okay, this is going to be JavaScript. So on the outside, the Java compiler, this is it's a native. I don't know how many folks here have done.
So this would be JavaScript. That's...
So this is JavaScript right here, embedded right in the middle of Java.
You might need to understand that.
I don't
have it
right
now.
So I don't know. What was the question? Do I need to understand that?
Yes.
Who?
What? The IDEs do understand it, and understand it pretty well. If you refactor its name, JSON, it'll
join the JavaScript. So which browser are you using, or which IDE?
It's all good.
So if you try to call it from Java, it would say, I don't have a library that implements that, because it would see as a native.
Right.
It would know that.
Right.
And so you can't call it server-side, because there is nothing supporting it in the JVM. And then the magic happens inside the comment, and it makes JavaScript literally out of it.
Yeah, I mean, what's really happening is the Java gets compiled out of JavaScript, and that JavaScript, this JavaScript gets embedded inside of this JavaScript.
Is that some kind of naming convention as credential, or is that a made-up name on your part? It's not required. It has some pattern like that.
There is a mechanism where you've got a static. You have a static method. This is how you can construct one. So given a JSON string, it constructs credential, and this is
factored method pattern.
Oh, okay, so that's the part of the GWT.
I've never done mining that way.
So it really is
like designing one. I couldn't. I don't have patience. I'm going to screw that up. I know I'm going to screw that up. I'm never going to be able to maintain all that. Sorry.
So it finds it by some mechanism. Either it's the only native that returns the same object or something. Anyway, it finds the factory object, finds the factory static method, and uses it somehow.
And this is not code I wrote. This is code I stole off of a web post. Somebody was suggesting, here's how you do this. And I'm like, no, that's not how I do this. Just because. It's just going to be too clever. I don't care how fast
it is.
Well, so I'll mention that one of the projects I think I mentioned, 50,000 lines generated, 50,000 lines of Java, 50 lines of that. And that was for things that GPT at the time didn't have. But there were 50 lines of handwritten JavaScript. And they were another thing like that. Stuff like fetching cookies at the time.
Speaking of which, George, you want to talk about the performance issue we ran into with serialization and graphs?
Go ahead.
Do you remember that?
I know that we were pulling in lots of stuff.
Yeah, there was. So, I just realized the security. Remember the thing I touched on about security? Now again, because you're pushing more of the state on the client side. And again, I don't know if another thing you have to pay attention to now is how much data you're sending to the client and how often you're sending it. I think what we were doing was we were actually doing charting on the client side, and you were sending like too much data onto the client, and it wasn't able to keep up. Like that was one of the first performance issues that you ran into, from what I remember.
This was in which company?
Ventus.
Okay. So I believe it was the CTO.
Don Edward.
Ken.
Oh, he was the chief scientist.
Chief scientist.
Yeah.
So Ken then went on to Doyens, which is like this, some of the slides. So you guys is after the GWT, you impressed him enough that you entertained using the technology again. However painful it was.
Ken was pretty, doing some pretty weird magic. He basically was doing graphs for tens of thousands of divs.
Huh.
So he didn't have a common canvas or anything like that in 2007. So he was literally doing the math to say, oh, this line is straight enough, I can make a deal with this 4 pixels long. Or in the vertical flat. Otherwise, I'm going to put 1 pixel deal.
Where like you put all of the different slopes of the line and you show the line background and you do that. Oh my gosh.
But in the context of serialization, though, that's another thing you gotta be careful about is performance lines will all your ship down.
But here's the thing, is that if you just say that I'm doing nothing more than classic client server applications using job serialization on PC calls, then all the same rules apply.
Yeah.
You shouldn't be sending 10,000 objects across the wire.
Right. Even if it's in your enterprise and the
I will touch on really briefly the next slide, but in this slide, I just want to point out, does anybody here look at auto beans? It's a great technology where you define some interfaces, and then they will, they'll do serialization and auto, they'll auto-generate, they'll basically auto-generate this stuff on the client side. And that's the goal of auto beans. But you define an interface, and then it creates this value object, which to me is not very useful. So
it's a pure hot drop object, not even one extra method or another. It just is set.
You as the author define an interface. When it compiles into the automated stuff, it generates a class that's got the behavior in it for getters and setters using JavaScript to use the JSON encoding, decoding, or serialization. So you don't necessarily have to do all those manually, but then again, you end up with an object that doesn't make behavior. It's a value. So maybe I'm a bit of a purist, but that's why I say beware of automated beans. Had they said, okay, actually we'll create an auto bean that knows. We'll add the auto JavaScript stuff ourselves to optimize. If you give me an abstract class, the abstract class has, you know,
the generation, the generational pattern. Yeah.
This is just to show how URPC, URPC, just to show that this is just my show just how easy it is to use with RPC rather than. We talked about this. This is one. Of course, I'm doing this. Last time, you said only what you mean, implement a reference object so you can reference instances of existing items here. So, you know, let me use UUIDs or primary keys or whatever you use. Set your system up so you can send over and say, I'm really referencing this UUID, this object, and you've already got it just in your client and then to get it that way. That way you're not sending an entire graph. I'm going to send an entire graph, only 10% of those changes. I'm just going to send 10%. You change 10%, and it still connect up to change stuff. So, of solutions that we're talking about on the mobile side, we're talking about Enterprise Java, and it's running in iOS, and we're using a hybrid application that's got a browser built into it. It is possible that they may not, for the embedded window in Apple, I know that you may be doing hybrid applications, and they may want to do some lock-in. So they, as I understand it, the embedded web window is not as fast as the browser, even though it's got the same underlying technology. So I haven't seen this myself. I've heard reference to it in a talk, and so I want to keep my eyes open for that.
It's basically got what I understood. I was hoping they had fixed this, but it had one generation back of the JavaScript engine. The new one runs, does a lot of accelerated stuff and runs close to bare metal, and they apparently did not want to turn that on for some reason that I was not quite clear on, but they took the conservative approach and they're using basically the previous version of the JavaScript. So basically it runs as fast today as it would have with the browser in what, iOS 4 or something.
Yeah. What's the motive?
Does GWT or GWT abstract out the new HTML features where you store data on the client side? Essentially, you could use those in both places, or in your client, wherever it happens to be running on the
computer. So,
I mean, are you access
data? They are working towards implementing more HTML5 either themselves, or you can also look at things like phone gap. Which also provides those HTML5 features.
As a WID-compatible library or something with the GitHub?
Right, so PhoneGap is native code, and we'll, oh, by the way, apparently we don't have a slide here. We talked about PhoneGap. PhoneGap is a cool wrapper. It was built by a company called Adobe. Adobe bought them in October. Open source it, gave it to Apache, it's not coming out to Cordova. And so this framework is a wrapper that will allow you to run your JavaScript in all kinds of different platforms, web OS.
So then we have the same problem we had with the Java platform definitions for small and large phones or something, with the PhoneGap libraries, you have to know what the platform supports or something, crazy thing like that. Or least common denominator JVM kind of solution where it only does what everybody can do.
Well, there are these core set of things that are HTML5.
I guess it has to do with HTML features as well.
And then you can add it actually with plugins.
It has different directories for different phones, Windows Phone, Android, iOS, different directories, libraries.
So you can drop in features you find by some third party builds that can now get to your contact list or something, and we will all integrate together. Right. Well, it sounds too complicated.
Anybody hear from Adobe?
I have a question. I used GWT probably like 3 years ago. How is it progressing? Is it still being actively developed? Is it like how often the releases happen?
I think it's basically the control. No, twice a year.
My question is related to integration. So you talked about what technology, and I've been with the technology for a long time. But my concern is a little bit, it seems like WIT has peaked kind of around 2009, and when I talk to Google folks, they won't say about right, but they also indicate here and there that it's kind of fading away. So because there wasn't really traction. The adoption rate was kind of disappointing for me, that they're moving on to JavaScript and HTML5. Or large, they're kind of trying to use it. So what's your take on that? Or other people's take on that? And where the future of your products?
I think those are great questions. I don't have any insight into Google. I do think that they have a limited sized team, and I think sometimes it needs to be a little more built vision at Google. So I think Sergey was recently quoted as saying, put more wood behind fewer arrows. And so if I could make one suggestion of JVGT, this is one arrow. I think when there's
talking about Dart and using all different languages, we're developing to Go.
Go is pretty cool, but unfortunately, it's they've left in the critical. I'll just mention, I contacted some people at Google and I said, I want to talk to who's in charge of Go. I said, there's nobody in charge. Literally, that's what I said. There's nobody in charge. And for GWT, for the longest time, it was a 20% project. Until Wave came along. And I think that's where the 2009 aspect came in. When Wave came out, it was all written in GWT, and it caused a huge number of really cool changes to GWT, fractional loading and all that stuff. And Wave didn't catch up.
Is that an email?
No.
It's not email?
None of the big projects, Google Docs and email are in GWT. When I was at one of the Google conferences, I asked about it. I said, well, if they had GWT, they would have written that stuff in GWT. But they now have all those libraries already written.
But I think it's a bug.
More consciousness of puzzle to move those to all the new projects on top of GWT. That's your choice.
Well, so I have a friend who was on a Google project. He said he couldn't believe that they were writing a brand new application for businesses as a Web 1.0 application. No Ajax at all.
Thank you.
And just
it takes a long time. I mean, look how long it took Microsoft to get to .NET. They developed library after library that some people characterized as being foisted on the developers. Presumably, they were trying to use them internally, but they could never get anybody to do it. And so it took, 15 years from Microsoft Foundation classes to .NET being used for everything. And I still think it took an act of God,
I think so too,
to do that. And people were basically, their livelihoods were threatened if they didn't sign on. But, Google will probably have the same sort of problem, whatever tool they develop. It'll take like three versions before we get rid of the
cancer.
I always thought that the whole emphasis behind GWT was let's write a system so that the Java developers can create these UIs, you know. And so it was all about let's leverage what Java developer and no swingisms and so forth. And press a button and then you got the whole stuff that nobody knows how to write correctly. So write it for them. And Tim, I thought that was the main reason for
Ruby.js is built on the GWT backend. So, I know that the GWT team is saying that the next version comes out when we're ready. Period. There are no deadlines.
What's the
backend? So if you've ever had a chance to look at the generated JavaScript, it is incredibly
obfuscated
and terse. They do things like they've determined that the methods are faster and method names are shorter.
Well, so we're going to use methods.
First thing they're going to remove the method, but then they'll look at how many calls, not runtime, but
static operations.
And they will short programming those method names down to two characters. Right. And then the other thing they found is that the things they put in the dictionaries first are faster. So they put all these short names on top. And so the closure compiler basically said, we'll take regular JavaScript and we will optimize it the same way GWT optimizes the JavaScript.
The key compiler checks if your program doesn't actually do anything useful, just by compiling your program. It's better optimization.
And if Google did nothing more, open source. There's enough there to build all kinds of applications. Now, I think that would be unfortunate, and I haven't heard any indication that Google plans on dropping
questions over and over again. The office is improved, but all of them look like 100% information to the future. And the trajectory is definitely not going to happen. And they told, and they said also, they kind of supported about the adoption of the development. It actually hasn't been
So this is an interesting second life for it, not just George's problem of a complex app in the browser and doesn't want to write all that JavaScript. This is you could pack it into something and ship it off to one of your phones. You're saying it's a cross-platform solution.
I'm going to write one solution to, one slightly more. So, I'm going to run it on every client, and I'm going to have a couple different layouts depending on the screen size. And that's the goal.
So I'm currently at Amazon, and Amazon has decided that all of AWS configuration is going to be GWT.
So that is not.
So when you go to the AWS console, you go to areas, I think about a third of them now have been converted to GWT. And it's probably 18, 20 people doing just that. The team I'm on, which is not AWS, has got 6 to 7 people on doing GWT for a different console.
Where are you?
Can you talk about where you're at?
I kind of started. So I talk a lot to start with in front of developers. They don't like AWT because they're in the JavaScript world and it's really hard to convince them to do. It might be the right way. I actually like all the infrastructure of Java. So bring all the power of Java to, it has a lot of power in many ways in scripting stuff.
So is there a problem? If it was written from a developer standpoint, Java don't achieve that form, then it's taken away from the UI guys who are not Java.
Yeah.
You know, they're taking
the UI
guys. The mode of development is different too, right? I mean, in JavaScript land, you're in a dynamic environment. You make the changes, you build the page, boom, it's there. This is more static language land.
And another thing with jQuery, JavaScript looked much easier. I mean, at least from my perspective. When I started to do JavaScript like 2-3 years ago, it was a nightmare. Now it's just much, much easier. It's much more manageable.
Yeah,
you got much less level.
The functionality level if you're applying from that.
And unfortunately, I think for Google, jQuery came on the way. I think jQuery was a different answer to the same question that the GWT guys were trying to answer. And so were the new tools and a couple of the other ones.
So one of the problems with GWT is that as they point out, it's not a framework, it's a toolkit. And as such, one of the things that's nice about jQuery is when you go to jQuery, you're embracing jQuery. That's what you're going to code at this level, raise as well. GWT doesn't give you a lot of fancy animations and all this other stuff. And so you either have to write that stuff yourself, or you have to buy a library that does it. But whereas with jQuery, so many things are just there from the get-go. But to me, personally, jQuery was sort of like Visual Basic. I can throw together this really cool demo in a day. But then it'll take me the next 4 years to actually deliver the enterprise application.
That's the next step. Alright, that's the next step.
Alright. Well, I think on that note, I think we're going to go over just a little bit. So thank you very much for having me. Thank you, Brendan.
Thanks for coming, Jayson.